Well, welcome all to this afternoon tutorial. This is the third one, and we are very happy indeed. We have Donca Steriade from MIT. Well, meaningless to say something or describe her work. It's impossible to describe her work, because if we only say one word, phonology, well, some names are coming to our minds, and one of them is Donca Steriade's name. Well, I remember from my time at Lund University in Sweden, in any course in phonology, we had one or another paper, Donca Steriade's work. Well, I remember an analysis of classical Greek, a very excellent analysis, I must say. Donca, I have never asked you, I should sometime, because the classical Greek, the accent distinction is very, very similar to the Scandinavian ones, and specifically the Swedish one. An excellent analysis. Well, Donca has been many decades at MIT, and the most dedicated scholar in phonology. So we will just listen to her and see what she has to say today. As I have seen, it's recent things in optimality theory, OP, or whatever it's called. And I'm curious to hear, because I'm not so accustomed to this line of research. So Donca, please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Adonis, and thank you, everybody who is here. I have been asked by Adonis to say a few words about myself. So I am Romanian. I grew up in Bucharest. I was trained as a classical scholar in Bucharest. And in the course of being trained as a classicist, I discovered Ferdinand de Saussure. And I thought he was the coolest thing ever. And I wanted to do what he did. And eventually I managed to come to a country where linguistics was actually being studied, and discovered an even more interesting way of doing linguistics than Saussure was practicing at the beginning of the 20th century, and did that under the guidance of Chomsky, Halle, and Paul Kiparsky at MIT. And then after some years, I returned to MIT in 2001. All right, so this is about me. Now I want to tell you, I've been told by Adonis that I should not take for granted knowledge of optimality theory. So therefore, I will, the first time we encounter an OT analysis, I will go a little bit slow, and then hopefully everybody will be on board with what I say. So I will now begin to share my screen. And okay, so let me just make sure that I have the right file that I'm sharing with you. Yes, I'm sharing the correct file. So let's go. This is the title of my talk. It's Phonology and Paradigm Uniformity. And I should begin by defining what a paradigm is. This is a set of lexically related words. And a paradigm is uniform when these words are systematically similar or systematically identical in certain cases, or I will extend the term to also mean the situation in which they are systematically dissimilar. And by systematic, I mean that a grammar contains statements that guarantee either the similarity with respect to certain properties or the identity or the systematic dissimilarity. So I want to talk about the fact that there exist multiple patterns of paradigm uniformity. One of them is well known to all scholars of phonology nowadays. This is cyclic inheritance that we've learned from Chomsky, Halley, and Lukov. But there are a number of others that I want to present today or present an analysis, a revised analysis of those. So one of them is pseudocyclic inheritance that various collaborators of mine and I myself have studied. Then another one is inflectional paradigm uniformity. So this is similarity for the stem of inflectional of paradigm cells. Morphemes, these are cases of syncretism among syntactically arbitrary pairs of stems. And paradigm contrast, so that's a case in which the grammar dictates a systematic distinctness between certain cells. All right, so we have five of them, and you can see now that you see this blue icon there that lists the four or five list, the full five item list that I will come back again and again because I am interested in the properties that they all share. The properties that they share, and there is a particular property that they don't share. So first of all, they involve systematic and unexpected similarities and dissimilarities. Systematic in the sense that their grammar enforced, and unexpected in the sense that the grammar of simple words lead us to expect greater dissimilarity or greater similarity. So the grammar of simple words doesn't lead us to expect these cases. They are surface-based, and that can be shown by showing that they involve the similarity involves predictable properties. They are directional in the sense that one form determines the shape of the other forms in the relevant set. And they are recursive in the sense that they can define chains of transmission. And all of these things will be explained repeatedly throughout the presentation. So if you missed some of them, I will come back to it. The basic idea of the tutorial is that, first of all, as I said, many of these properties are shared by all five patterns of paradigm uniformity. And that suggests that there are common underlying mechanisms. Currently, the analysis of the five patterns differ without any shared element, or in many cases, there is no analysis. In some cases, we are discouraged from looking for an analysis. Here I'm referring to morphemes. And I will have a partial proposal for a unified treatment, and you will see at the very end that the proposal is just partial. Okay, so beginning with a cycle, which may be familiar to most of us, for which there are references both in the pre-optimality theoretic literature and in OT. Here is an illustrative pair, the verb fit and the prefixed version of it, refit. Yes. Are we good? Okay.
Yes, please continue.
Okay, so Athena, should I stop and talk?
Please continue.
All right. So they are systematically similar in the sense that all pairs of monosyllabic verb and prefix verb operate in the same way. They are unexpectedly similar in that a grammar of simple words of English would lead us to expect refit, like profit. The dimension of similarity is a surface property, namely stress, which is largely predictable in English. And they are directionally similar in that refit adjusts its stress to fit. And finally, they are recursive. So if you can generate more and more prefixed forms, and then stress will continue to be unfit. All right. So it's possible to provide an analysis in cyclic rule application terms, a la Chomsky, Halley, and Lukov, in which we begin with an underlying representation of the innermost constituent. That would be fit. Let's suppose it doesn't have any stress. We apply the rules of stress. We get one stress on it. And then on the second cycle, which is defined by taking the output of the first cycle as its own input. So that's how we get fit with stress, with a one stress on its unique syllable. Now we affix, we reassign stress, but we don't lose the stress that we've inherited from the previous cycle. And that gives us the output refit with a 2-1 stress pattern. And now we can compare this case to that of a disyllabic. So this is a disyllabic form, but we can compare its different stress to that of a disyllabic verb like profit. In that case, we have two syllables in the input, and therefore the first cycle of stress is giving us penultimate or non-final stress, because in English, non-final stress tends to be the preference. So that's how the cycle is giving, is yielding an account of this difference between the morphologically complex case and the morphologically simple case by simply reapplying the stresses on every cycle. Okay, so now this is the original cyclic model in which rules apply once per cycle. But there is a problem with this, which is that whenever we have evidence for a pair being related in this cyclic way, the base derivative pair is more similar than expected. And the rule application does not guarantee similarity between the base and the derivative. So there is an essential property of cyclic patterns that is not guaranteed by the model of rule application. So here is an example. The verb to discipline has antepenultimate stress, and the ing derivative of that continues to have initial stress on the verb. So we have disciplining. So if we were to reapply stress on the second cycle after we have added ing, then we would get disciplining, which is not only wrong, but because it's wrong, but it's wrong because it differentiates the stem of this derivative from its base. So in other words, it's wrong because it is dissimilar, because the base and derivative are dissimilar. So then that leads us to wonder what guarantees similar base derivative pairs, and what guarantees them are explicit similarity conditions of the form advocated by McCarthy and Prince way back when, under the name of faithfulness. So these are sets of constraints that require identity between certain pairs of forms. And what we need here is surface identity between certain properties of the base and certain properties of the derivative. And this is violated every time they mismatch for a particular property, which I named X. So here we need X to be stress. So there is a distinct class of identity constraints involving identity between the underlying representation and the surface representation whenever they mismatch for the same property. But we will see that those are distinct and they operate in different parts of the ground. Okay, so here is an account of the refit pattern. So we start out with a base fit, ident stress base derivative, which penalizes a form whenever it mismatches the stress of its base. That requires that the stress of the stem, which is fit, be preserved. So this is why refit, which is a good form otherwise, it satisfies non-finality, gets a penalty, and given the ranking, it loses. So let me talk a little bit around the OT structure here. The input is always in, so the input or the relevant forms that we're looking at are in the top left cell. Variant realizations of the same surface representation, so so-called candidates, they are in the column on the left. And then the constraints, that is the static statements of one-formedness, they are arrayed left to right in the order of their importance. So that the importance means that if two constraints conflict, then you will want to satisfy the one on the left. All right, so this is the a simple account of refit and an account of why we don't get refit. And now we compare this to the case of profit. So in the case of profit, the constraint non-finality, which says you can't have stress on the final syllable, that actually plays a role. And what's important here is that the word profit does not have a base. So going back to the first tableau, here we had a base fit, which was embedded inside the form refit. In the case of profit, there is no fit inside profit. And therefore, nothing prevents us from assigning stress on the initial. stress, right? It just expresses the tendency for stress to occur towards the right edge of the word. So now that is giving us an account of the difference between refit and profit. Fit itself has predictable stress, and we can obtain that by ranking non-finality below a constraint that says you can't have zero stress in a word. So non-finality would be satisfied if we assigned no stress, but that would then run up against have stress, and therefore we assign a stress even though that violates non-finality. And now that we understand sort of the entire system, we can go in sequence first through the generation of the base. So we produce fit, assigning it one stress, and then we generate a derivative, producing refit rather than refit. And that kind of gives us an account of the data that we've discussed thus far. And now for another derivational sequence, which is somewhat more interesting, this is dísciplin. In dísciplin, we see that it's not only the case that English doesn't like to stress the final syllable, it doesn't like to stress the penult either. And this is what a constraint extended non-finality says. So dísciplin is out because of extended non-finality. And dísciplin then becomes the better option. So now we've now generated the word that is embedded inside disciplining. So that word is now the base of disciplining. It has a stress 100. We add ing, and now we observe that if we try to get a somewhat better stress, like disciplining, which would be the stress pattern for like, let's say, America or Connecticut, that would violate ident stress based to derivative because we have a base in this case. And therefore we violate the markedness constraint, which I refer to as stress right. In this case, it's actually a different markedness constraint that we'll talk about in a bit. But stress right is also gets more violations if you preserve the stress of the base. And that's what we are doing in this case. Let me give a chance to people to ask questions if they have questions to ask at this point. And so I will stop sharing as I've been advised and welcome any questions of clarification that you have until now, just for the sake of not losing you all at the same time. Okay, so I'm seeing some people nod, so therefore I will continue. If you don't ask me to clarify anything, then I will continue to share. All right, so we've done this. We have a single hierarchy for simple words, for morphologically complex words. We can generalize this along the lines of Laura Benoit's ideas. So we say that correspondence between the base and the derivative is at the top for much of English phonology. Markedness is in the middle, and correspondence for certain properties like stress between the input and the output, that is between the underlying and the surface representations, is at the bottom. So now I want to recapitulate what we've done thus far about cyclic inheritance in the OT analysis. So we have systematic similarity that's guaranteed by the constraint hierarchy. We have similarity for a predictable property that includes stress, which is predictable. We have an asymmetry effect that was called by Laura Benoit base priority. And that is that there is a markedness cost to the similarity that obtains between the base and the derivative. And that cost in markedness terms is borne by the derivative alone. And the derivative, whenever it's similar to the base, tends to have more markedness violations or more otherwise unmotivated markedness violations. And then there is recursiveness, as in rare fit, in that the derivative in one pair can become the base in another pair. And now there is a critical property that we haven't talked about yet, and that is cyclic containment, which is that in the cyclic patterns, which is what Chomsky, Halley, and Lukov, and the following literature talked about, the base is always not just a subconstituent of the derivative, but an immediate subconstituent of the derivative. This is kind of a critical property of the cycle. And there is empirical evidence for it, which I will not discuss during the lecture, but which I'm very happy to discuss and give evidence for at the end of the, during the discussion period. So cyclic containment holds for cyclic inheritance in this sense that the base is an immediate subconstituent of the derivative. And now we're going to turn to other patterns of paradigm uniformity, beginning with the inflectional pattern, in which all of the properties that I said before hold, but not see containment. So, all right, so here is a paradigm defined by the features, by the inflectional features f and g, with alpha f and beta g being their values. And so here you have a full paradigm in which the stem is expected to be a little bit different due to the fact that there are different affixes being attached to it, and therefore the phonology causes a little bit of alternation. And in certain cases, the attested stems are actually similar or identical, contrary to expectations. And moreover, some of them deviate from the expected phonology. So this is called directional uniformity, in the sense that all cells adopt a particular stem. Let me, my computer advances the slides even when I don't tell it, when I say nothing to it. So there are cases in which then we have uniformity in the stem. So you see here that all of the stems are superscripted with an I to indicate that they are identical. And they are sometimes identical or similar beyond what you would expect from the phonology. And they are all of them identical to a particular one. So here is the one that is being highlighted. So this is directional uniformity. All of the cells adopt the stem expected in the pivot of the paradigm. And there is a ton of evidence for such cases. And we'll discuss just one, and maybe during the discussion period, the second one. So here is Romanian in the perfect verbs. You can see here that stress is all over the place in the non-perfect. I've given the example of the infinitive, but generally in the non-perfect, the stress alternates. But in the perfect, you can see that the stem is segmentally identical throughout. And moreover, the stress is always on the U. Okay, so we have kazut, kazui, kazush, and so forth. So in the perfect participle, the simple perfect, and also the pluperfect. So you can see all of these cases have identical stress in addition to having identical segmental stems. So now we first show that there is predictability and directionality in the system. Stress is predictable. It falls on the final syllable if that one is heavy, as in kadem and in the participle kazut, and it falls on the p-naught otherwise, so kade kazuta. So these are regular cases. So it's important to understand here that a perfect participle gets regular stress. But we're getting unexpected stresses in the simple perfect. So we'll get kazu rather than kazu. And we also get unexpected stress in the pluperfect. We're getting kazuserum rather than the expected kazuserum with stress on the final syllable that's heavy. So from that, we can infer that in the set of forms that are all perfect, including the perfect participle is the base, and the verbal perfect forms copy its stress from it because they are its derivatives. So that will be captured by the same kind of hierarchy that we used in the case of the analysis of the cycle ident stress base to derivative, assuming now that the base derivative relation holds between the perfect participle and the verbal perfect forms, a bunch of stress constraints and ident stress input throughout. So here would be an analysis of this form. We generate the base first. So we use the underlying representation as our starting point. We rank stress heavy above non-finality. Stress heavy requires stress on a final heavy syllable. Non-finality doesn't want stress on the final, on any final syllable. So we assign stress on the final. And now, so that gives us kazut. And now this form, the perfect participle, becomes the base of all of the perfect forms. So they become its derivatives. So now they're going to be required to be identical in stress to it in virtue of the ranking ident stress base derivative above the markedness constraints on stress, including non-finality. So we're seeing here kazoo violating non-finality rather than kazoo which does satisfy non-finality, but violates, in fact, twice, identity-stress-based derivative. And here is a pluperfect form. Again, its base is a perfect participle, kazut. It violates, the correct form satisfies identity-stress-based derivative. It violates stress-heavy, since we're not stressing the final heavy syllable. If we were to do that, then that would violate identity stress-based derivative, so that's not possible. Okay, so exactly as in the cyclic inheritance case, we have a single hierarchy. The hierarchies look very much similar to what we have for English. All right, so now we come to the point of this tutorial, which is the status of C containment in this case. The case of the cyclic patterns, C containment is satisfied. So in a case like dísciplining, we've seen that C containment is satisfied in the sense that dísciplin is an immediate constituent of dísciplining. But in this perfect paradigm, the base is not a subconstituent in any derivative. And that is because the perfect forms are not contained in one another. And we can see there are multiple arguments for this, but here is a very simple one. If you unpack the morphological structure of kazut, you will see that there is a morpheme u, which is a perfect marker. And then there is a t, which represents the perfect adjective marker. That perfect adjective marker has no place, syntactically speaking, it has no reason to be in the verbal forms, which are not adjectival, and indeed we do not find it, okay? So, but then that shows that a perfect participle is not a component inside the simple perfect or the pluperfect. Okay? And just to make that double clear, I've said here that the t, which represents the exponent of the perfect adjective, is not found in the third person simple perfect form, and it's not found in the pluperfect. Okay. All right, but here is the issue that is of interest to us here, and that is that the stress of the base, kazut, that is due to the T. T made the final syllable heavy, and this is why the final syllable attracted stress. The stress in kazoo is due to similarity to the base kazoot, but not to the presence of the T. So, so then that establishes that the base is not contained in this derivative. So this is important because it sort of shows, it's our first bit of evidence that in this case, C containment is violated. And that raises three questions. Why does this pattern deviate from C containment? Why is it that the perfect forms have identical stress? And why is the participial perfect the base of the perfect paradigm? So I'm going to try to answer them, but in a slightly different order. So why do the perfect forms have identical stress? That's because similarity signals a shared syntactic feature. So I follow here Luigi Burzio in trying to say that one function of similarity is to signal morphosyntactic structure. So the feature perfect aspect is being signaled, among other things, by perfect correspondence, that is by the surface similarity between perfect forms. So there is a constraint that says that. Why is the participle the base of the perfect paradigms? There is an informal reason, which is that this is by far the most frequent form among the perfect forms. I don't know yet how to build that into the analysis, but I haven't lost hope of that. And then finally, why this pattern deviates from C containment? And the answer is actually rather simple, and that is because C containment is actually a violable constraint. So we're not thinking about it anymore as an architectural principle of the grammar, but rather as a constraint, an exponent's constraint that can be ranked very high, as in certain parts of English, and can be ranked relatively lower in other parts. And in this particular case, perfect correspondence outranks C containment. So building on these ideas, we can have an analysis that now extends what we've said before. So what causes the perfect participle, that is the base kazut in our example, and verbal perfect form like the pluperfect, casuserum, to resemble each other is because they are both perfect. In virtue of that, they have to enter into perfect correspondence, even though that violates C containment because one of them is not contained within the other. So as I said here, the co-superscripts indicate correspondence. So the top candidate satisfies perfect correspondence, even though it violates C containment, and that's the good one. And now based on that, we can observe what we've seen before, which is that the whenever there is correspondence between the base and the derivatives, they are also similar, and that is why, again, the candidate Roman one wins. Okay, so this is an expanded hierarchy of the analysis we've seen before. So this is simply building in perfect correspondence and C containment to be explicit about it. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about the alternatives that we could have to this. And in particular, there is a popular and interesting and creative alternative that was proposed by John McCarthy in 2005, building on work by Michael Kenslowitz. This analysis was inspired precisely by the belief that C containment is an architectural property of grammar. So you cannot have a base derivative relation between forms that do not stand in a nesting relation. In an inflectional paradigm, there is no asymmetry, there is no directionality according to McCarthy, and therefore there will be no deviation between there will be no deviation from C containment in the analysis. So the analysis consists of saying that the stems of all members of an inflectional paradigm correspond, which means that they are expected to be identical, and the paradigms are penalized for each mismatched pair of stems. So there will be, in fact, they are penalized for every feature property, for every property with respect to which any a pair of stems is mismatched. This works very well for systems that are have completely uniform paradigms, and for a subset of the systems in which the paradigm is not uniform. It can fail for certain partly mismatched sets of paradigms. That is, for sets of paradigms in which there is a mismatch between the base of the base and the derivative in certain cases and not in all. And in particular, it fails rather dramatically for the Romanian perfect and for ancient Greek nouns. And so for the Romanian perfect, there is a paper of mine that explains how that is. And for ancient Greek nouns, we can discuss this. I have the slides. We can do that during the discussion period. So let me summarize what we've seen about the inflectional paradigm uniformity pattern. There is systematic similarity that's guaranteed by the constraint hierarchy with respect to predictable properties like stress. It's asymmetric in the same sense in which cyclic inheritance is asymmetric. It's recursive, although I haven't shown that for Romanian, it can be shown for Latin. But cyclic containment, C containment does not hold in a subset of these cases. And it is, in particular, it is violated to satisfy constraints like perfect correspondence, or more generally, constraints that involve enforced similarity between paradigm cells within the same paradigm to signal shared morphosyntactic features. Okay, so now I will, if you have questions, I think Athena will let you unmute yourselves.
Yes, you can raise your hand at the participants tab. You can press raise hand if you want to talk, and I can assign the questions. And also, you can also type in the chat.
So let me stop while Athena is talking. So
yeah. So for any questions, please raise your hand at the participants tab.
Okay. So we're good. I gather we're good to go.
Yeah.
Yes, I would like a small question.
Ah, yes, Adonis, yes.
Okay, well, it's a little bit peculiar Romanian. Either the stress comes on the ultima or penultima, depending on whether the syllable is heavy or light or whatever.
Yes.
Wouldn't it be a better description if we say closed versus open syllable instead of light high, light heavy?
Okay,
it might be just a matter of terminology, but I...
So actually we do have diphthongs in Romanian. We have diphthongs in sort of similar diphthongs to the diphthongs. Actually, we have a variety of diphthongs and triphthongs and quadriphthongs, and they create heavy syllables. So that's partly the reason.
And the other thing is, Romanian, what I saw, I would guess that intervocalic consonant is syllabified to the left. Is it right? Or on the right? I mean to say, Romania is an open syllable structure language or a closed?
I see. So you are influenced by your residence in Lund. Where Swedish is reported to be a language in which the syllables are closed. So if you ask Romanian speakers for their intuitions are that a unique consonant goes to the second syllable.
Okay, yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, Antti has a question.
I was wondering about the nature of this cyclic containment constraint, whether it's I guess it's a faithfulness constraint, right?
It's an exponent's constraint. It gives you a penalty for every time you have a relation of correspondence between two forms such that one of them is not an immediate constituent of the other.
And
so it's not really a faithfulness constraint, because C containment, it doesn't actually enforce faithfulness in any way.
Yeah, but it keeps track of what is included, right?
So it basically says you can't correspond. If you want to correspond, you can't correspond unless you stand in this nested relation.
Okay, I think I missed the point about the morphosyntactic features that kind of drive the identity effect.
Could you elaborate
on that? How exactly does it work?
Okay, so in the perfect participle, which also happens to be a passive participle, and the verbal forms, the simple perfect and the pluperfect, they all share aspectual features. All of them are perfect. So aspectually, they are identical. They are not identical with respect to other syntactic properties. So the participle is an adjective and it is passive. So it has a voice and lexical category differences, whereas the verbal forms are both, can be active if the verb is transitive, and they are verbs, they are not adjectives. So that T that was present in the participle and absent in the verbal forms, that T signals adjectival passive nature. So it cannot be present in the verbal forms.
So it's the most important, let's say, morphosyntactic feature of the paradigm, the one that controls the identity effect, right?
That feature is the aspectual feature. Aspectual feature that gives you the identity.
Okay. So there
Thank
is no
conflict much.
Between features. We don't have cases where maybe features may conflict.
Yes, they do conflict. As to the principles that dictate, so of course in principles they conflict. So you can imagine that you will have the preference for each and every feature to trigger correspondence. And that's not going to be possible because you can only have identity between certain pairs of forms. So you're raising the question of what are the principles that determine the choice?
Yeah, exactly.
I have no idea. I have no idea, but if you look at Adam Albright's chapter on inflectional paradigms in, I know I will try to remember where that chapter is, but it's going to be on his website. It's Albright 2011. He mm-hmm. has a one paragraph discussion of this, where at least he grants that this is an issue. Mm-hmm. Okay, but yes, that's a good question that remains, as far as I know, unanswered.
Thank you.
Philippe okay. Martin has a question.
Yes. Philippe?
Yeah, I have a question, Athena. I couldn't find the raised hand. I'm raising my hand. Yes. Okay. My question, Donca, is about in Italian. If you want to predict stress, an easy way to is to classify suffixes and flexion into stressable and non-stressable, and then you just left with the rules of the root in Latin. In some few cases with heavy vowels or light vowels. So I was wondering, in Romanian, I have no idea, is it possible to view things like that, or it doesn't make sense? What? So to classify independently of heavy vowel, heavy syllables and so on, but just classify them as a stressable or not stressable. Yes.
So in particular, so I think this is a very good question because it suggests that perhaps we're stressing the oo because it is inherently stressed or because it is yes. stressable. And I try to argue against that analysis in my paper. My paper is not yet, as far as I remember, it's not on my website, but anyone who would like to read the paper, I'm very happy. So just drop me an email and I'm very happy to send it to you. Because that, and it argues against that possibility, because that's an important alternative that we should consider.
Yeah, because in Italian works very well. It was a computer simulated and giving 99.9% the right answer.
Yeah, I didn't know. So maybe if you can send me the reference to yes, the work that does that, I would very much okay. welcome that.
Very thank good. You very thank, much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. So if I see nothing. No further hands, so I'm going to go back to the presentation. Here we go. Okay, so this is now the pseudocycle. This is based on work that I did with Juliet Stanton for the last few years. This is a pattern of stem identity between derivatives and related words. But related words which are not immediate constituents within these derivatives. So the pattern is directional, and because these are not the related words are not embedded, it violates C containment and does so to satisfy markedness. This is what I'm going to try to show. There is evidence from quite a few languages that this is true, that this is a real phenomenon. So here is the beginning of the an outline of the kind of data from English that illustrates this. So you have these two OID forms. My computer advances the slide, so I can't prevent it from. So it's paraffinoid and gelatinoid. They differ in stress. The suffix is the same, but the bases are identical. So now it's paraffin and gelatin. So why should there be a difference in the stress of the derivative if the suffix is the same? And the reason is that one of them, namely gelatinoid, has a related form, gelatinous, which has stress on exactly the second syllable that is where the stress in gelatinoid sits. So gelatinoid is also possible, okay? But this is this preferred. In fact, you won't find it in the dictionary, and that's because it violates LAPS, so that is a dispreference against two stressless syllables. Generally in English, Latinate words avoid LAPS. So you can see that in morphologically simple words, at least in English, like manipulate, apocalypse, metabolism, and depaminondas, the well-known word depaminondas in English, where you don't stress the initial syllable because you want to avoid LAPS. So the claim is that pseudocyclic effects in English, they aim to satisfy constraints like LAPS or clash, that is adjacency of stresses, while maintaining faithfulness to an existing related word that is more common than the form being generated. So here is a way to generate gelatinous. So it's important to see what we have here in the top left cells. We have what I call the local base, that is the base that satisfies C containment because it is an immediate constituent of the derivative gelatinoid. And then there is a remote base, B superscript R, gelatinous. Okay, so both of these, I'm claiming both of these are participating in the generation of the OID form. They propose different stress patterns for the stem of the word. And they're going to be judged by this combination of constraints. This is a base derivative ident stress that we already know. And what is important to understand is that the base is whatever the derivative decides will be its base. So the derivative can opt for the remote base or for the local base. So it's relative to that base that you calculate the stress identity. So that's one constraint. There is a markedness constraint here, lapse, and C containment. So so there should be a violation for C containment. Let me make sure that I, there should be a stress here. Let me stop the show for just 1 second to make sure that I, there is a violation of C containment. I couldn't see my entire screen. There is a violation for C containment, and let me restart the show. In the winning candidate gelatinoid, which satisfies faithfulness to its own base, which is gelatinous, it avoids lapse just at the cost of violating C containment. Gelatinoid that violates the markedness constraint lapse, and gelatinoid with reference to the local base that will violate ident stress because gelatin is the local base. And in the case of paraffinoid, we don't have a remote base, and therefore there is no option to violate C containment, and we get a somewhat less good form paraffinoid because BD ident stress is top. All right, so when we talk about cyclic derivatives in English, like paraffinoid, they are, in the case of the Latin vocabulary, the ones that lack an optimizing remote base, so because there is no paraffinous word. Pseudocyclic derivatives, they have a remote base, like gelatinous. And otherwise, the grammar is the same. Okay, so now, across Latinate derivatives, we get tons and tons of pairs like the ones that we've seen here. So pacification, yields the stress in pacificatory because the remote base is specific, whereas classification, so notice that identical stress in the local base, but a different stress in the derivative classificatory, and that is because there is no remote base that will give us a better stress. And all of these are similar examples. And I want to talk about the medicine and jettison case. These are both, if you take them both to be verbs, they give rise to different able derivatives, medicinable and jettisonable. So I want to talk about these because they show further property. So we're now talking about whether we I'll stop the show so that the slide does not advance. In the case of medicinable, we have the verb to medicine, and we have the remote base medicinal with stress on the second syllable. Okay. So in the case of we're talking now about the able adjective that is based on the verb medicine. So notice that medicine has initial stress, but the able form, as given by the OED, has stress on the second syllable, as does the adjective medicinal. Okay. So the relevant constraint here is a variety of lapse that penalizes sequences of three stressless syllables. Or you may have different analysis if you use feet, but it's going to be the point is going to be the same. So if you match the stem of the able adjective against the adjective medicinal, you will get medicinable, and that will give you one violation of extended lapse. Whereas if you match the verb against the stem of the able form, that will give you two violations of extended lapse because you have two distinct sequences of three stressless syllables in a row. And now, skipping the candidate C, let's look at once more at a candidate based on the remote-based medicinal. Let's try to see that if it's possible to improve the stress even more in such a way as to completely eliminate extended lapse violations. And it's not possible because it's still the case that the able word has to have a stem that matches the stem of its base, which in this case is a remote base. So if we have medicine trying to match the stem of medicine, so if we have medicine trying to match the stem of medicine, you will get two or three ident stress violations, which is more than zero that you're aiming for. So this is okay. This is a point that can be shown. And compare that with jettison, which doesn't have any related form, and therefore you have to say jettisonable. All right, so now with this in mind, let's summarize the properties of the pseudocyclic patterns because they're going to rely to some extent on this comparison. So there is a systematic similarity between the remote base and the derivative, in addition to occasionally there being similarities between the local base and the derivative. So medicinal versus medicinable. This is a surface similarity because it involves a predictable shared property. And in particular, the stress in medicinal is predictable from the fact that O is the suffix that is contained there. It's asymmetric in the sense that the remote base dictates the shape of the derivative. So this is why it's now important to understand that medicinable, remember, it contained an extended lapse violation. We couldn't really make it a good form. It was, so it's marked because it has to be faithful to the stress in medicinal. So that is the sense in which we're having an asymmetry here too. The remote base medicinal dictates the shape of the derivative. And I don't know about recursiveness. Clearly, there is no containment in that medicinal is not embedded in medicinable. Okay, and we know that from the syntax of verbal words, these are deverbal derivatives, whereas medicinal is an adjective, so we cannot talk about syntactic embedding, in addition to the fact that we don't see the all suffix. So C containment is violated here, and it's violated to satisfy markedness, that is to avoid lapse. All right, so I want to say a little bit about work that Juliet Santen and I did to test the productivity of this pattern. So we did a global study of the English dictionary of all of its Latinate derivatives, which are about 27, getting all of the forms and the stresses from online dictionaries, including the OED, which we mostly relied on, and focusing on the derivatives whose faithfulness to the local base conflicts with markedness. So we asked for each derivative in this humongous set, does this derivative have a remote base like medicinal, such that the derivative would have a better stress if it was faithful to the remote base? And is this better remote base, this optimizing remote base, actually being used? So is it the case that the derivative stress is similar to the remote base and not similar to the local base? And alternatively, so we're looking for alternative explanations of the patterns that we found. Is there a frequency effect in being able to predict these cases? So we did that over the last few years, and we've done recently walk tests to try to see whether people can also compute these effects for nonce forms. So here are some sample dictionary results for EFI verbs. To give you a sense of what you find in the dictionary, there are 42 EFI verbs in which markedness and a faithfulness to the local base conflict. The vast majority have a remote base that is optimizing. So Germanify has Germanic, okay, but its local base is German. Okay. So in this case, these are the bulk of the cases for EFI. Lapse is satisfied because stress shifts right with respect to the local base, and it can do that because there is a licensing remote base that allows it to do that. And then there are the somewhat smaller number of cases in which there is no remote base, So this is the column of cases with no remote base. And of course, we expect that these cases will not shift the stress. And indeed, we have Englishify and not Englishify. And then there is one cell that is unexpected, but it's barely populated. These are the cases that in principle could shift stress, but don't. So you don't have to torify. You rather, the OED list tutorify. I suspect tutorify is not so bad. And then there are comparable results for somewhat more noisy for E derivatives. I'm not going to give you all of them, but this is just for the E. Expected results are in the on the cells that lie on the diagonal from the northwest to the southeast. So you have, let's say, E derivatives from Ordain, ordine, as if with a stem that comes apparently from ordination, not from Ordain, even though like Obol E is a deverbal form. And so this is when you have a better remote base, you use it to avoid, in this case, to avoid clash. And if you don't have a better remote base, as in the case of divorce C, you don't shift the stress. So this is divorce C with stress, with secondary stress on the prefix of syllable. And then there are a rather large number of cases that are not expected, including, let's say, provokee with a form that doesn't avail itself of the existence of provocation, or parolee with a case in which you've shifted the stress to the left without observing that there is no parol in the English lexicon. But generally speaking, even for the E cases, which are noisier, the effect obtains. So the results across the English lexicon show that we have an effect of better remote base. That is, so the predictor of remote base is significant for 12 of the Latin derivative types that I've listed here. It cannot be detected for 9 of them because there are too few forms that actually have optimizing remote bases. So we cannot test the hypothesis. And generally speaking, no Latin derivative of English systematically deviates from the model, which looks like this. So you have ident stress-based derivative, then a bunch of markedness constraints on stress and C containment. Whereas all Germanic derivatives deviate. So C containment is above markedness in that set. I can say much more about exactly how we integrate the Latinate and the Germanic cases into a single analysis, but this is a sketch. And there is yet another class of derivatives of English that you may be wondering about, things like all or us and iti, then I can discuss those during the discussion. Okay, so we tested through logistic regression analysis against this set of forms, of sort of a subset that where the data could bear on this hypothesis. We tested 4 hypotheses that reflect the analysis. These are, one of them is a predictor corresponding to our analysis, namely, if you have a better, an optimizing remote base, then the stress of the derivative, if it conflicts, if there is a conflict with markedness, will match stress of the remote base. And then there are a bunch of frequency hypotheses that can be turned into predictors. The frequency of the derivative, the relative frequency between the local base and the derivative, and the relative frequency between the remote base and the local base. And it turns out that the existence of a remote base is always significant in this data set. And the frequency predictors, sometimes they get close to being significant. Sometimes they are significant, but quite frequently they are insignificant. So the only constant effect in all of this is the one that is predicted by our analysis, namely, if you have a better remote base and markedness conflicts with faithfulness to the local base, then you will use that. I want to talk about, for just a second, about the walk tests we have been running. Recently, these verified predictions of the hypothesis that this pattern of pseudocyclic identity is actually productive. So these are not accidents of what happens in the lexicon of English, but this is something that people learn. One prediction is that nonce derivatives that have optimizing remote bases, that is, that will get better stress if the derivative is faithful to the remote base than if it's faithful to the local base, they will match the remote base stress, provided, that's a second hypothesis, that the speaker knows that word. So of course, that brings up the question of what different people know. So we compared in one experiment the stress preferences in nonce derivatives with and without lexically. Let me stop here. That have lexically listed remote bases. So let's say both moralify and choralify, or in either stress, moralify or moralify, choralify or choralify. These are nonce words under any stress. In one case, there is a related word morality, and there is also a local base moral. In the other case, there is a local base choral, but there is no chorality. Okay, so we compared pairs of these sorts in which one benefited from a remote base and the other one did not. We checked in the second step that the speakers who prefer, let's say, moralify, know morality. Okay, so that is critical. So we thought it was critical, and perhaps it's not, but I'm now reporting what we thought initially. So here is what we did. We checked the preference for nonce derivatives with optimizing remote bases known to the speaker. So let's say moralify provoke, okay. In related work, Kanan Bryce from UCLA has done work on UBL that came to the same conclusions, and on work on similar patterns in Spanish. So, the results are encouraging in the sense that so of both the Standard and Steriade study and the Bryce study show that you have a significant effect in the result of the speakers knowing the potential remote bases, even though when it comes to preferences among nonce derivatives. And I'm also now currently working to check preferences for nonce derivatives with nonce bases. So these are cases in Romanian in which you can figure out that a certain word, even if you've never heard it before, should exist. So these are, let's say, the plurals of nonce words, which can be projected from knowledge of the gender of the relevant word. And then from knowing the plural, then you know all sorts of other things about possible derivatives. So it's we have initial results in that line that also are quite encouraging. So now just to show you how such an experiment would work out, in the case of EFI, in part one, the participants read aloud the local base and the derivative in a paragraph. So they would read aloud, fats go rancid in this temperature. In fact, they rancidify overnight. So they read that silently. And then they were presented with two recordings, one of rancidify and one of rancidified, of course, with randomized orders. And were asked for preferences and the strength of their preferences. So that was part one. And then in part two, they were asked, by the way, do you know rancidity? The real question here was, do you know rancidity? Because it is based on rancidity that you could figure out whether rancidify is has one stress or another. So in the second part, they were asked about the knowledge of words like rancidity, which is a listed word, although very rare, and also whether they know other words like candidity, which is not a listed word, but which bears on the pronunciation of candidify. So this is how we determine whether people knew the words that they were supposed to have, knowledge of which was supposed to have applied in the stressing of the nouns for. Okay, so I will just mention, I will only mention one of the remaining two forms. This is paradigm distinctness. So this is, we're going back to the, we're going back to the list of patterns of paradigm uniformity. So I'm saying here that the definition of distinctness is that members of a paradigm are pairwise distinct phonologically, or they are at least distinct with respect to some property, like stress. And an alternative possibility is that only the predecedential stems are distinct or are distinct for that property. So I'm interested here in the observation that distinctness is directional, in the sense that one form surfaces as predicted by the general grammar and another form deviates from the grammar in order to be distinct from the first. And in addition to the directionality, which is really the purpose of this little piece, we can observe that distinctness is surface oriented and it can be recursive. So I'm in the process of figuring out whether that is so from a paper, an old paper on Terena. So here is work by Katia Pertsova that shows directionality. This is based on work that Roman Jakobson had done on the genitive plurals, but it's considerably more expanded than Jakobson's observation. So the starting point is that the genitive plural in Russian tends to be zero, that is to have no affix, unless the nominative singular of that noun is also zero. The nominative singular in turn is predictable based on gender, with typically zero being the masculine exponent, a being the feminine exponent, and o being the neuter. And the genitive plural has a bunch of allomorphs, which I've only mentioned two, but prefers the zero. So examples, stol, stalov. So here, because we have a zero in the nominative singular, we can't have a zero in the genitive plural. Rieka, riek. Here we have a something in the nominative singular, and therefore we can have the zero in the genitive plural. And slova, slov. Once again, we can have the zero in this case. So Pertsova shows that there are certain data sets that indicate a preference for paradigm distinctness. So in particular, if the genitive plural in zero does not cause surface homophony, it is used even in masculine nouns. So if the masculine contains a singulative suffix like in, so grajdanin, then in the plural, which is missing the singulative suffix, you can have the zero for the genitive plural. And if the nominative singular frequency is either zero or negligible, then at some point in the history of Russian, the zero in the genitive plural was usable. So it used to be the case that you would use more frequently the plural of gram, the word for gram, than the singular. And that allowed the genitive plural, the zero genitive plural of that noun to be used. Okay, so this is evidence against the rule, a rule that says if your noun is masculine, then it takes a genitive plural in of. That's not the case precisely in those cases in which homophony is avoided in some other ways. So here is a variant of Katia Pertsova's analysis. I've changed slightly her statement of the paradigm distinctness constraint, which is PD. Basically, you want to have paradigm distinctness between the genitive plural and the nominative singular. And if that constraint is satisfied, then you can have your preference for the zero genitive plural. And that is the case for grajdan. Okay, that's not the case for stol. So therefore you have to have stalov. Here we have a summary for what we've seen for paradigm distinctness. We have systematic dissimilarity between the base and the derivative, as we have seen here. This is surface dissimilarity, and the evidence for that is in various other works, including in Katya's paper. The system is asymmetric in that the base or a particular form dictates the shape of the other form. So in the particular case of Russian, the nominative singular is selected independently by gender considerations, whereas the genitive plural is determined by the nominative singular. Whether it's recursive or not, that depends on what sense we can make of the terena. And there is no containment, at least morphologically speaking. So the nominative singular reka, let me remind you of this data. So the nominative singular reka is not contained. So this is the base of the genitive plural in this system, but it's not contained inside the base. So that's a sense in which no containment, no C containment holds in this particular case. Okay, I will skip the morphome here. We can talk about it, but I think I'm over time. So I will summarize. We've talked about four of five paradigm uniformity patterns which show parallel properties. They are systematic, unexpected varieties of similarity or dissimilarity. They're surface oriented. They refer to predictable properties. They're asymmetric, and some of them can be recursive. In the original processes that kind of inspired the analysis of the cycle, asymmetry and recursiveness were derived from C containment. So if you read back to the original work on by Chomsky, Halley, and Lukov, these patterns were derived from C containment, and actually C containment holds in the particular data that they were looking at in 1956. But we found asymmetry and recursiveness in patterns for which C containment doesn't hold, or hold as a viable constraint, ranked sometimes below markedness constraints and sometimes below constraints like perfect correspondence. So it's possible to give a unified analysis that covers much of the data, though not everything, if we say that the C containment is not a property of the grammar, but rather a constraint that can be violated. There is one big gap, which is that exactly how the bases are selected in cases where C containment is violated is not yet understood, so I will stop here. So I will now stop the sharing and give you a chance to speak.
Okay, thank you, Donca. So her questions from Katya Petrova.
Hi, Donca, thank you very much. That was great. Looking forward to reading your paper. But I have a question about C containment. So how much do we actually mean C containment? It seems like, I'm sure there are some, so you found that in Germanic derivatives that seem.
So like things like ing, so let me, I now forget my own English stress, but I think that in English you have, let me think of a, okay, so remember we have the verb medicine and mm-hmm. the adjective medicinal, okay? Mm-hmm. And remember, so now if you add a Germanic suffix to ing, the Germanic suffix ing to medicine, to the verb medicine, that will be medicining. I am medicining somebody. You cannot say I am medicining somebody.
So are you assuming that it is somehow indexed for different strata or
no? Like so it's yeah. So no. So I'm assuming that it's actually the markedness constraints that are. So I've simplified the presentation drastically. It's actually what we argue for is that the markedness constraints are indexed for the lexical vocabulary that comes from that is Latinate versus not indexed. Okay, so what I talked about when I said lapse, that is actually the variety of lapse that is obeyed in the Latinate vocabulary. And similarly, extended lapse, that is a variety of extended lapse that the Latinate vocabulary is sensitive to. Okay, so this is, so then the full analysis does not involve strata or changing rankings. It's a single constraint hierarchy, but many of the markedness constraints are indexed either for large groups of lexical items, or they are indexed for particular affixes. So in particular, let's say all or it or us, they require additional mechanisms that require these particular suffixes, which are just a subset of the Latinate vocabulary, to be indexed for additional conditions that I haven't discussed. So there is a certain amount of indexation, but in the markedness constraint, in nothing else.
Okay, I see. Yeah, I guess I'm just, containment just seems really, it's basically sneaking in derivation into a T, kind of, right?
It connects in a way. So it tries to recapture the intuition, which seemed to be correct, of Chomsky and Halley, which is that you have the similarity relation becomes very important if you have this embedding structure. So I will walk you through the evidence for C containment in English. But okay. I want to give other people a chance, and then we can come back to this question. Thank you very much. So I think, okay. Yes.
Ludmila, please.
Hello.
Ludmila, yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your interesting talk. So can you show me, please, some slides with Russian examples? I think there are some errors there.
Ah, okay. So let me share my screen with you.
Yeah, so with river, with граждан, and so on.
So if there is, if I misplaced my stress in...
Yes. The previous one. So with river, Rika.
Yes.
Yes, thank you. So feminine, nominative singular. Russian stress is in nominative singular feminine, Rika, but not Ryaka.
Ah, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
And the next slide, please.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Гражданин, it's correct. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So then you're pointing out that the example of given that the stress is on the ending, then
not on the step, that's right.
I think Katya's logic for with respect to this data remains the same.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I saw some more raised hands earlier. Please raise your hand again if you have any questions. Or you can write in the chat. Okay.
I have a question if there is
I see Holger who has a question. Hi, Holger.
Thank you for your talk. And I hope my question actually has a base. As a lowly psychologist, my grasp of OT is not that great. But I was wondering, with the use of the remote bases,
yes.
One question for me is, where are they coming from? So basically, the remote base can only exist if another form already violates C containment. So how is that possible? And then even going on another meta level of theories, you're arguing that complex morphological words are built here.
Yes, that's
which
correct.
Which means that the lexicon would not even contain these remote base forms because they would need to be built as well.
So no, that's correct. So because the remote bases have to be created, that makes them comparable to cycle one. Okay. So remember that in a standard derivational view of, or in a C containment obeying view of the cycle, you begin by generating certain forms, and then you continue by generating on the basis of the forms that you have generated first. You then continue to you create others. So this is one possible story. In the case of English, the remote bases have two sources, and so one source of them are forms like medicinal, which are coming from knowledge of stress patterns dictated by certain affixes that I haven't discussed and which have particular lexical properties. So in particular, all, it, us, and ik, they require stress to be in a particular region at the right edge of the word. That's not the case with the vast majority of the Latinate affixes, which are sort of more yielding with respect to the actual position of the rightmost stress. So in a descriptive sense, we understand what the sources are for the remote bases. They are, on the one hand, these words like morality and medicinal that are being generated by affixes with very strict affixal stress properties. On the other hand, they are also generated by underived forms, that is by irreducible cycle one. So let me share my screen again to show you that. I'm going to share this, but I'm not sure that this is, okay. Yeah, no, so this is, okay, excuse me. Okay, so here we go. Can you see this?
Yes.
Okay, so let's consider the pair reflexive and reflective, or actually apostolic and alcoholic. These are both local bases. So there are four local bases. If you go from Roman 3 to Roman 6, yeah, they are local bases for four derivatives. Apostolicity, whose stress is like apostle. Reflexivity, whose stress is like reflex, versus alcoholicity and reflectivity, whose stresses are like alcoholic and reflective. Okay, so, All right, so these two cases, they illustrate the fact that a remote base can be the innermost cycle in a three times derived form. Okay, so these forms are constituents. So apostle is a constituent in apostolicity, but it's not an immediate constituent. And similarly, reflex is a constituent, an inner constituent in reflexivity, but it's not an immediate constituent. So one thing that I haven't shown because I didn't have the time was to show you that C containment actually demands, when you go outside of the Latinate lexicon, that only immediate constituents are count as bases. That is, you only inherit the stress pattern, let's say, of the immediate constituent. So C containment would be preventing you from doing this here, but of course markedness is more important than you. Apostolicity is a better satisfies clash than apostolicity. There is something comparable in the case of reflexivity. So let me stop sharing now, and I'll be able to look again at Holger and try to see if I satisfied him. So what I try to say is the following, that we understand what are the sources of the remote bases. What we don't understand is how to formally model the fact that the remote bases in English stress are coming from these two sources. We can say in the case of the simple cases, like let's say reflex, becoming reflexive, becoming reflexivity, we could say that we have a sequence of a sequential derivation where we create reflex, then we create reflexive in ways that I haven't shown you, and then at the very end we can reflexivity can refer both to reflex and to reflexive, and chooses to refer to reflex. That's the idea. That doesn't cover everything. The forms like medicinal having an influence on medicinable. And so while we understand where they're coming from, I can't tell you right now how to model that. And I'm working on that, but I haven't made progress on that. Thank you.
Hey, thank you. That at least clears the question up. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, Connor.
Thank you very much. This is very interesting. I have a related question to the previous one, which is around, I suppose in the first case, are you able to build in a certain flexibility between speakers of these languages, English in this case? So you were just talking about apostolic and derivatives. And I think despite it being very unlikely that I would ever use the double derived word from apostle that you cited, my instinct would actually be to say apostolicity. Which in this case is a little bit arbitrary. And I think maybe at a push, it would be marginally as good as the example that you give. So rather than go on about that for too much, I just wonder whether that can be built in. And then the second one, just to get them all out of the way so you can answer without my going on, is around your WOG tests, which I thought were very interesting. And I really like the idea of testing productivity of these rules on words which don't have a lot of historical baggage attached to them. So you have, if I understood correctly, words like rancidify, and then you test afterwards whether your participants know the word rancidity, and then that's supposed to be the remote form that they then reference for their preference for the stress of the word rancidify. And I think as a native English speaker, my instinct, if asked, do you know the word rancidify, or rancidity rather, isn't so much that I know the word rancidity, but I know that it's a possible word from knowing the word rancid and knowing the word eddy, which I know you were sort of addressing already, so I'm sure this is nothing new. But I'm just curious how that would be addressed, I suppose, with respect to what it means to know these remote forms with respect to non-words specifically, because I don't know that I would say I know the word rancidity so much as knowing that it could exist.
Yes, thank you very much. So going to your first question, on the question of flexibility, of the subject's intuitions about whether to violate C containment or not to violate C containment. There is considerable fluctuation on this that was observed by Kane and Bryce, and that we observed ourselves, and that I've observed ever since Adam Albright as a student told me that he prefers to say remediable instead of remediable because it's the verb remedy and not. So yes, indeed, people fluctuate. Whether the fluctuation reflects a momentary lack of access to the optimizing remote base, that's one possibility, or a momentary preference for satisfying C containment, I do not know. What is striking is that in the OED, that is among people who study words for a living and who put stresses on words for a living, my sense is that they represent a very systematically C containment violating dialect of English. So my sense is that it's perhaps there are regularities that separate some speakers from others, but I don't have data on this. And when I looked for, Kanan has also looked for data on this, and For the moment, he doesn't have results that would be encouraging, suggesting that things are very by speaker in a way which would verify the existence of different grammars. But this is just a beginning, so I don't know. On your second question, which was about the WOG tests. And now I forget what the question was, what the actual question was. Okay. So the question was about the fact that some of the particular example that I read there is actually illustrating something that was unintended, but happened to be in the example. And that is indeed for certain words of English, you know, that if you have an adjective like candid, it will have an EDT derivative. Even if you have never heard the EDT derivative, you, for some reason, you do know that any adjective in candid or any noun in candid, like druid, there is a potential for druidity. And then you use that, you can use that in the in generating an imaginary remote base. So we had some results of this sort, kind of modest, in the English data set. We had much more results of this type in the Romanian. So in the Romanian example that I haven't presented to you, but which is sort of parallel to English, many more cases of this sort in which you don't know a word, but you know that it is, let's say, a masculine that will have to have a certain type of plural. Based on that inference, you infer the phonological property of the plural, and based on these inferred properties, you know how the rest of the derivatives of that word will operate. And we have some very encouraging data of that sort, suggesting then that in the case of candidify, insofar as people preferred to say, preferred candidify to candidify, there has to be some other explanation or this ability to infer a non-existing remote base, that is a fluctuating ability that comes and goes, whereas the memory of actual words, that is a much more solid, that's a much, much more solid part of your linguistic equipment. So that's perhaps what I would speculate.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, Anthi.
I have a question. I mean, I have a couple of questions, but I think I'll ask one about Russian. Since you mentioned the inflectional paradigm with the genitive, I was wondering how does this theory, this analysis work with the fact that stress in Russian is kind of unpredictable, so it shifts to the derivational suffix or on some non-inflectional element. But sometimes it doesn't. So I was wondering whether you have any ideas about that. And if I may, I would also like to know how does compounding fit to the whole story with sea containment?
Okay,
which one to answer if we don't have enough time? But
I'm assuming that Athena will shut off my mic when we're out of time.
No way.
okay, but with respect to Russian, there is work on Russian stress. So I think the Russian stress does not interact with the analysis of paradigm distinctness that Katya Pertsova has proposed, but Russian stress does interact with pseudocyclic analysis. And there is a paper of myself and Igor Yanovich that's on my website that is very much like the pattern overall is very much like the English stress pattern. So if you have an inflectional, if you have a paradigmatic mobility of accent in the paradigm, then the derivatives of the relevant noun, then they can benefit from all of the different allomorphs that are generated in the inflection. So that's a sense in which there is a connection to stress. With respect to stress itself, there is an analysis of stress not in Russian but in Ukrainian, but those are related, by Luba Butska from Rutgers from 2002, that I think builds on the idea that you want the stem of the singular to be inflection, to be accentually distinct from the stem of the plural. That is true for a certain certain classes of nouns in Russian, not for all of them, but for some of them. And that then generates inflectional mobility. So it's kind of a paradigm distinctness constraint that generates inflectional mobility. And we, so Igor Yanovich and myself, we built on Luba Butska's analysis to build our own analysis. But yes, this it's possible to think of Russian stress in the mobile paradigms in terms of a paradigm distinctness. Okay. I don't know if that was your question, your first question. Your second question I'm coming to.
Okay, thank you. So I guess there is some kind of co-phonology then, because certain, let's say, kind of paradigms others do not.
Yeah, so yes, you can, if you like co-phonologies, you can use co-phonologies. We simply index some nouns as requiring a distinctness, as being indexed for paradigmatic distinctness that requires accentually different stems in the singular and in the plural.
Yeah, okay.
So as for compounds, you want to talk about compounds? If Athena lets me talk about compounds, then I will share my screen.
Yes, please.
Okay, I will share my screen in that case. So here is my screen. So we have to advance a lot because it goes past the end. Okay, so here is the argument for C containment in compound stress. This is based, data comes from Lieberman and Prince. It has been questioned recently by various people, but not in a way that vitiates the argument. So I'm going to continue to cite them. So you have compounds like hay fever treatment, where primary stress is initial, secondary stress is penultimate. Right branching compounds like business credit card, with primary stress on the second word from the right. Noun compounds like that are left branching, like law degree requirement changes, primary stress on the left, or left and right branching compounds, law degree language requirement with primary stress on the second word from the right. So we can analyze all of these cases in the following terms. We can talk about a base derivative constraint that says don't reverse the relative prominence of the base in the derivative. So that means that if the base has a particular, has a member that's more prominent than the other member, then don't reverse their relative prominence. You can reduce their degrees of stress, but without reversing their prominence. Then there is a constraint that says you can't have stress, main stress in the compound on the last word. This is much of this, aside from BDI dentral prominence, a lot of stuff comes from our ideas that are already present in Lieberman and Prince. And then main stress, right, which is that the rightmost word is main stress. So the overall hierarchy is relative prominence above non-finality in compounds, above main stress, right? And so here is, so if we have C containment, then the inputs to a compound like hay fever treatment are going to be the two immediate constituents of that compound, which will include hay fever and treatment. Okay, now hay fever has this particular pattern of prominence with initial prominence on the first member. And that is in virtue of the fact that hay fever itself is generated so as to satisfy non-finality word. Okay, so that's we're not having hay fever because non-finality word would be violated there. So our input to hay fever treatment is then hay fever 1 to 0, treatment 1 to 0. And now, oops. We can't say hay fever treatment with primary stress on the last word because that would violate non-finality word. We can't have hay fever treatment, because that would violate ident relative prominence. Because that would reverse the prominence between hay and fever, which used to be hay fever, and now it's hay fever. Okay. So then our best bet is hay fever treatment, demoting the stress on the second member of the compound and demoting equally the stresses on what's left. So this avoids by C containment because both the base one and base two are both immediate constituents of the entire compound, and we're only looking at at the stresses of those two bases. We're not looking at the stresses of the individual words. So that's a sense in which C containment is satisfied. Okay, so now without C containment, so I want to show that if you don't have C containment, you go wrong in this case. So let's suppose we have B1, B2, and B3. So this is hay, fever, and treatment. Then ident relative prominence, I'm going to show you a bunch of candidates which don't violate ident relative prominence within the word. So the stresses are not going to be moving inside the word. So we can then have a better candidate, hay fever treatment, okay, which better satisfies main stress right. So it brings main stress closer to the right edge, okay, and doesn't violate ident relative prominence. And it doesn't violate that because we have no access to hay fever, okay? So this is, this doesn't abide by C containment. And that's because B1 and B2 are not immediate constituents. And the moment you let them into the evaluation as inputs, you get a wrong winner. And actually, even if you allow them as inputs into the evaluation alongside the compound hay fever, you still get the bad result. So C containment then ensures that you do not have access to these guys. Okay, so in other words, C containment is fully satisfied in English compounds. And that goes along with the fact that it's the English compounds, they don't follow the pattern of the Latinate vocabulary. They follow the Germanic system. So I am going to stop sharing to see your faces. So does that answer your questions?
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, Antonis Botinis.
Okay, thank you, Donca. Well, I have a lot of questions, but okay. If I try to confine to one small and one big, can I take both or one?
I'm happy to stay here. You guys run the show.
I take the small one. It's a detail, okay. But still, I see you adapt the system, NRE stress, 1, 2, 3, etc. Well, from my side, I am convinced at the lexical level, we have only one stress. And the other things, like Vadersly and Ladefoget in 72 was dealing with binarity against the sound pattern of English, if you remember.
Yes.
Okay, because if you take all these words like demonstration, if you say one word phrase, it's not only one word, but it's a phrase as well and a sentence, which one unit. So many prosodic things will fall in the same domain. But if you put demonstration in a frame and you put focus somewhere else, you don't know, or I don't know what is going to happen.
Adonis, let me understand. So are you disputing the actual existence of multiple degrees of prominence in English? You are disputing that. I see. So I thought you were taking the Chomsky-Halley and Lukov position, which is that, yes, we can have an infinite number of degrees on the surface, and we do have very many of them. but we don't need more than a binary distinction of accent versus lack of accent. So they were saying that in 56, but now you're saying even on the surface, you don't have more than a binary distinction. But that seems to go against the evidence of various people, including Bruce Hayes in his book on stress from 95, that you can test multiple degrees of stress with various tests and sometimes with measurements that seem to indicate that there are in fact multiple degrees of stress. So I don't want to, I can't really do more than just assert that people have argued in favor of multiple degrees of stress on the surface. But I agree with you and with Chomsky and Halle that we can start out with just a binary distinction.
And then this low degree language requirements, only yes. Gods know what the speaker has in their mind, if it is one word, two words, two phrases, or whatever.
All you need to do is, so in this particular case, the argument that I just presented hinges on the location of the main stress, which is very obviously marked by pitch excursions. And so if you just replace everything, all of the twos and the threes by N, so as long as if you have one, N, and zero, the argument that I just made for Anti still stands.
Well, okay, we can continue our discussion in the future. Now I'm going to the big question.
Okay.
I had another big question about features and those distinctive things and so forth, but you haven't mentioned them. So we go to the one here related also to the stress. Well, the reality is like this. Languages differ. English has a lot of reductions. Only stressed syllables are full syllables. Everything else is reduced. It is as if we talk about a consonant language in a way, in contrast to Italian, when you hear every single vowel, even Greek. Okay, now the question is, like we have done with lab speech, hyperarticulation and everything is clear cut, like the phonologist writing on the paper something, it's there. But if you go to spontaneous speech, like radio, the American radio, you know how fast they talk. Okay, or any spontaneous speech in any language, if you register and you analyze it phonetically, you see we live long units without pronunciation, even syllables, not only consonants or vowels. I can remember an analysis, the Swedish, natur like this, which is naturally, they pronounce sometimes not this, two syllables instead of five. All theories, generative and later, accept an underlying structure. Good. Assuming there is some surface structure, which is some type of phonetic structure. And in this case, phonology would have some phonetic basis, though complicated. Okay, you accept it. But what is happening when we leave out syllables, consonants, vowels? My approach now, in contrast to the one I had when I was writing my PhD thesis, when I was saying that distinctive structures or categories will have acoustic correlates. That was my position then. Well, now, with my experience, I say that only stressed syllables are fully realized, and they are some stability islands in speech production. Then we leave those things, and it's the brain who has to interpret those things without existing. So we don't have, we have neither phonetic production, neither, nor underlying representation. It's the brain's job, which means most of the time when we listen to speech, we guess. Not most of the time, a lot of times. We think we hear, but we don't, because it's guessing. And it's the central, we have some kind of mental lexicon. It's the job of the brain to do the job.
So, but isn't grammar located in the brain?
There I would say it is some type of underlying structure. So what do you say?
So I don't think
structure, surface structure or phonetic representation, they are vague things.
No, you just appealed to, you have just appealed to the underlying representation when you talked about the fact that the brain is recovering a certain representation that it might not be supported by direct phonetic evidence. That is, in effect, so that is basically saying that you're using the grammar to recover a mental construct, which is the underlying representation. So we are in complete agreement about that. On the question of whether certain syllables actually are never realized on the surface, I don't know. I think that there is careful speech, there is casual speech, that there are varieties of casual speech. So of course, in casual speech, all sorts of things drop out. It would be interesting to see whether indeed there are English or Greek or Swedish are languages in which certain syllables that we assume are present on the surface are in fact never realized. If that is the case, then I would try to revise the analyses that attribute some surface existence to those syllables if they were in fact never realized, including in careful speech. Otherwise, I would simply say that it's possible to carry out much of the reasoning that I've presented here by reference to the careful speech, which is a reality and which is not strictly limited to the laboratory, but you can observe it in lectures whenever the lecturer doesn't speed up too much. So it has some empirical validity. But thank you very much for this observation.
Well, I think we could continue and continue our discussion, but sometime we have to finish. Athena, is okay. There anybody else who might?
I don't think so.
Okay.
If there's someone else, I don't see any hands. So
then we can conclude this tutorial. Donca, it was not only an interesting, it's difficult for me because I should stress one of the last three syllables, but I've learned from you, it should be your principle. Okay, it was not only an interesting tutorial, but a very, very pleasant one indeed. Thank you. Thank you very much. And we may have you often here in our company.
Okay. Thank you very much. Good to
see
you.
Thank you. And thank you all participants. A big applaud, please. Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.